To get started, it's just a few minutes after 7 o'clock. I want to welcome you all to the Northampton Senior Center. I'm Mayor David Garkowitz, and we appreciate you coming out tonight to this public forum on parking in Northampton. Just by way of background, the city is currently engaged in a comprehensive parking study. We've contracted with a firm called Walker Parking Consultants, which is headquartered in New York, but does work all around the country and around the world. And part of what we're trying to do is kind of take a step back and take a look at our entire parking system, take a look at our current facilities and technology, take a look at our capacity, take a look at our vacancy rates. And a big part of the kind of information we're trying to gather is information from consumers of our parking system. Who live here, the people who own businesses here, the people who live downtown, and people who come and visit downtown on a daily basis and use our parking system. So tonight is one of the ways we're trying to gather information from the public about our parking system. We also have an online survey, which we hope people will also take the time to fill out. It's on the homepage of our website. If you go to northamptonma.gov, right on the left, you'll see a link for online parking survey. It's about 5 or 10 minutes, and we're hoping to get as much feedback as we can on that. So in terms of format tonight, I'm going to introduce our guest, Carolyn Krasnow, who's Vice President of Walker Parking Consultant, and she is the person who's our primary person working on this particular study. Essentially, it's really about listening and hearing the feedback that people have. So I'm going to introduce Carolyn, have her just speak briefly, and then we're really going to try to just open it up, have people recognize you, and have people offer the comments, feedback, experiences, ideas, whatever. So my pleasure to introduce Carolyn. President.
Thank you. Part of what we do these studies is we collect a lot of data. We collect records from the city about how the parking operates. We go out and do our own surveys. We look at occupancy in the downtown area. We look at how the parking operates. A lot of it, obviously, is also collecting data from people who live in the city, work in the city, and use the parking system on a daily basis. So I don't have an agenda. I don't have, you know, this is really sort of your session. I would just appreciate people kind of putting up your hands and or standing up and just giving me your thoughts. I really want to know how it feels to you use the parking system, what you think works well, what you think doesn't work well, what your frustrations are, what you'd like to see from the city in terms of changing the parking system, or is perfect.
Primarily downtown stuff. weekend or the, and we don't need to get any of those back. There ought to be some way of getting back to, distribution better, so, 60, 50, and we end up in,
I think this is a little bit outside the realm of the parking study. I am familiar with the issue that you're talking about. I have been using access, as well as other tools. These aren't, and we're trying to sort of look through it today, but, all the services that we're not having, I think they were actually not public safety. And they were actually on the case of property.
Yeah.
Property, which may or may not.
Right.
Those parking spaces were previously parked, when the building got built, it sort of compressed the area that he had been parking, which had been parked on his property and on our property and Kate's property, the property he purchased. So those spaces did go away as a result of it. But we are, we have that communication with Reverend Leader, and we've been talking about that a little bit, and trying to work through that. So it's not that we're not understanding the issue, but it's really not related to the city's parking.
It's definitely a parking issue. I mean, the building is simply out of town, it's not a title.
Yep.
And we end up with a little parking. I don't think that's right.
Well, I appreciate you going in there.
Very easy. First of all, I think the improvements in the area are great. And I also think that the system is going to move it down the town and keep it moving. My personal thoughts is that the council of the town, with that kind of decision, I guess, part of the person is just, so my reaction is, don't do that. Or if I think about the project, it's just, I don't know, it's great. And so, how do you do something to go over there? If there's one drive to be built, that's part of the study. I guess I would ask the question, do you expect more businesses downtown to grow? And how do rents, places of rents, impact businesses? I mean, if they're high rents, people may not go to the businesses. So I guess I'm trying to look at that business unit, and I'm going to refer to it. And I also was very consideration to go on,
I'm Mary Fan on the call for 274 Pleasant saying about when we have a building that has no immediate adjacent parking, it becomes a problem, especially when we don't have additional parking provided by the city around the streets or in the parking garage. Someone we're talking about the new zoning that lets us fill our lot essentially with a building and not provide for parking. I hope the study would look at some of the smaller buildings like my home and what they might look like in a 10-year down the road. My building has 20 parking spaces, 4,000 square feet, 2-story building. If I decided to go to 7 feet, put a whole bunch of condos and a newer plan parking, where will the people park? I think that's something that needs to be looked at in the study, hopefully, is if we really are going to grow to 4 and 5 story buildings, also in the business district, where will the people park? I agree with the other comment that the parking garage is a great asset. I have to say, since school started, there were 2 Saturdays I went downtown, middle of the day, and the parking garage was full. And I think we've all come to experience that. I'm a big fan of the parking garage, and it's convenient, it makes sense. But I feel like there's just a lot of times I wouldn't have expected it to be full and I'm having it full. But I really think that the parking garage makes sense. I know that this is on our topic tonight, talking about expanding how long the meeting run, because it's more rats at 5, at 5:30 or 6 at night. They're there all night, and they're kind of like, the business owner and other clients, the patients, and stuff. So those are my thoughts. I don't have the answers. I do like the idea of the parking garage.
Okay, I believe this is where my tonight's in the barns, 90 and I think that might be okay. At the same time, I think we need to consider that other communities too. So I think we have to be
where did you go with the last one?
I went and sat in the Maple Hotshots parking lot and waited for something to open.
Okay.
I also was with my mother, who's 80 years old, in a separate car. It was 40, and she could be on the way through town. And she wanted to see her granddaughter, so right in the middle. So there were 2 cars in the pouring rain, and she was 80. And so I'm just waiting, Mom, just waiting, and I saw it open.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't feel like how I used to feel about Northampton. It's a town that's sort of easier to get this one, but there's some highlights and comments. It felt like a little bit of a town.
My name is Joe Blumenthal. I own a music store on Pleasant Street called Downtown Thomas. Been here for 38 years. There has never been a time in downtown Northampton where there hasn't been a parking problem. It's always been some controversy. I think several things have happened over the last few years that really changed things. So the Northampton economy is actually developed so that we have a daytime economy and a nighttime economy. And the parking system has not adapted to that very well. And as Mary was just saying, I think that extending the hours of meters until 8 o'clock would probably do a lot to keep things moving in the surface wells after 6 o'clock, because people come there and they park for a very long time. And it's very difficult to find a space in the surface wells after 6 o'clock. Another thing that has really changed in the last 10 years is computer technology, and the city is just barely beginning to make that adaptation by, there's going to be a machine in the garage that will accept credit cards. So really, the parking meters on Main Street should also be outfitted so that they can accept credit cards. It's kind of standard technology in a lot of other places now. It's something that we need to do. The other thing, and I would also certainly support the idea of having another garage. I think the continued vitality of the business community downtown depends on having infrastructure that can handle the number of people who want to take advantage of it. And I know there's been some talk of been somewhat tragic with the garage behind the rest of the park, and we really could replace the one that was there. And it was held there, but I don't think anything's going to happen really this time. I want to say one other thing, and that is, when you think about the parking system, you really need to think about how the incentives work. And the incentives are organized in a fairly sensible fashion at the moment, but I think it could be pushed in the direction more so. That is, the most expensive places need to be on Main Street and the stores, because everybody who comes downtown wants to drive in front of the store, stop right there, walk into the store, and then drive the next way. And that's just not realistic in a simple business district. So those spaces need to be relatively expensive, and they're 50 cents an hour now, or they're probably $1 an hour. Probably two of them. And so that people who want to be there for a very short time will go there, pay for the short time, and the space will be open up. The next most expensive thing should be the service lots, depending on how close they are to the main street. And then the garage should be less expensive, because even though we have somebody say that they go to the garage first, and it's a very sensitive thing to do, most of my customers take part in the garage. They will go to the service lots and try and find space in the service lots and see and drive around and around before they actually go to the garage. I can tell you how many times I've seen people go to the garage. There's a free meal they put in here. They're going to park in the service lot on the street. And so that if the garage is less expensive, even though we have to spend a lot more money to support the construction of the garage, if the system is structured so that the street's most expensive, then the lots and then the garage is cheaper, then people will be encouraged to do that. And thank you very much.
I'm Mark Lerner. I also have my sort of partner here for the city, with two others in the back as well. I wonder if maybe you're aware of this already, but there are two resources the parking committee has already prepared. One thing we might think of is a time lapse of photography on the same way. Most of you don't know it, it's still a great feature, because it does show over a period of a month or so all of the useful downtown spots in the city, the periods when there are present parking spaces on Main Street, and the periods, you know, through the day, most of this is added on to go anyway to serve. It's very useful to also look not just at when spots are filled, but also to see which cars are remaining in those spots for many hours of the day. Mm-hmm. We just wondered originally if cars were parking, if people park at 4 o'clock, paying for 2 hours in a meter, and then staying there all evening. The data from the video shows that yes, that is in fact happening. Mm-hmm. So that would be something else to support the idea of putting the gate beyond the 6 p.m. As well. Mm-hmm. The other thing that we came up with was the idea of making sure that, really, in general sense, the parking revenue shouldn't be the same that the parking meters, the fees, the dollars, the enforcement, shouldn't just be to raise revenue for helping the city property, but rather to make sure that the maximum parking space is effective and efficient. And if we need to go and charge more than previous persons, so meant the idea of having a gradient as you go further away from downtown. And that makes sense. But also recommending what we need to allow some parking space. What we see have to be up as enforcement told you the ticket card that would allow you to go and ensure that there's some spaces free, some spaces that are available to people to park to help you to consider that. One of the other things that came up, and I'm not sure if this is the thing itself, I haven't seen the stuff, but is to consider the off-street parking requirements. And these don't apply just in downtown, but the city's off-street parking requirements are somewhat general. They group land uses together in a very broad sense, and then other towns, other cities, have a taking those specifications and looked at for more detailed land use. And I'm not sure if that would be acceptable to what happened, but where there have been cases that need to come up often is the issue where a land use has had a change use or has grown beyond the original purpose of the business. And the parking aspect of the office facility is not provided enough parking space. And it would cause some calculation for the environment. Are there, I hope that would be part of the study, and I think that it probably would be useful to consider the health in that as well. Given that there have been cases where the students are parking, have faculty as well, are parking well beyond the bounds of the college and the building requirements, or any other means to discourage students from bringing cars up there. And we are taking a space for the neighborhood. If that was something to consider, then it would be appropriate to have Smith take some measures. It would encourage students to bring the cars up there, or to provide additional office parking capacity. But that would be one issue, as well as parking party outside the downtown floor.
Hi, my name is Vincent Gillespie. Relevant, so I'll mention it. I'm the guy who filed a lawsuit in 2016. Part of the reason why that's relevant is that when I talk about the amount of the fees, it's 75 cents an hour, I believe, for about 30 years. The way that came about, as I saw, is let me back up. I've spoken to this battle is still ongoing. There's a website, massbrothersrights.com. I'm trying to get the role changed, but the ACLU is helping me. My case went to the Mass Supreme Court. I've spoken to hundreds of people, literally hundreds of people across the state during the course of this. At one time, I did a study of different places, different towns, and what they their policies work. Almost everybody supports what I'm doing. I'm trying to fight for the right for us to be able to take the parking fee appeal to court. Massachusetts is the only state that doesn't let you do that. One of the very few people who I've spoken to, hundreds of people who actually oppose what I'm saying is Mayor Claire Fagan. She was mayor at the time I filed the lawsuit. Well, when she retired, when she left, just right around that time, that's when they upped the rate from 50 cents to 75 cents. And I feel it was, I don't think it was coincidence, I think it was, you know, in my opinion, it was kind of an indignation type thing. And I think 50 cents is a lot more friendly. There have been a lot more of a friendly amount. It's, you're not, you know, 75 cents is almost a dollar. We've got a lot of business people here speaking about their side of it. But I think we also have to think about what it's like for a consumer, somebody who wants to come in and enjoy the town, you know? And I think raising the rates is, I don't think that's a good idea. I think I would urge that it be reduced. 50 cents, the fines would be the same. I'm not saying that the penalties, if you get the ticket, are the same. I think that's the greatest discouragement, having people stay a long time. But 15 cents, it would make it more friendly. I bet that there'd be a lot of people who would really appreciate it. It was 50 cents apart for an hour. And as I said, I think the fines are the main discouragement for people staying too long. And I would also say about extending the hours. Several people said extending the hours. Well, that might be, from the business people's perspective, that might be advantageous. But people coming in, it's like a lot of times you think, oh, if I get there after 6, all right, I don't need to worry about parking, I can park. I've never had trouble finding parking after 6, by the way. I find it. You know, maybe I have to go a couple of blocks out, you know. So basically what I'm saying is I urge you to keep in mind the perspective of somebody who doesn't live there, someone who's coming in to enjoy the town. I come from Worcester County. I come from about an hour. I still come here for various reasons. So, you lose some money by lowering it to 50 cents, but I would urge that. There's one more thing I'd like to say. I'd like to just do a plug. It's been going, I've been fighting this battle for all of your right, all of our right, fighting in court if you have an appeal to parking ticket. You can help. All you have to do is contact the people in the House Ways and Means Committee. The House is out of session right now, but I can still try to get the line of the House Ways and Means Committee. We recently had some success. We got it out of the Judiciary Committee. We moved over to the House Ways and Means Committee. Anyway, if you'd be interested in asking me to help, you can go to MassGarbageRights.com. MassGarbageRights.com. Sort of take action, please. So I think that's everything. I should explain. Yeah, but what I'm trying to change the law, right now, the way the law is you have, if you want to appeal a parking ticket to the court, the only avenue is to go to Superior Court, pay a $275 final fee, which is non-refundable if you win. That's the law in Massachusetts. Massachusetts is the only state in the country that effectively doesn't let you take parking ticket appeal to a court. New York is an administrative law system, but that's still way better. The bill I have that's pending, Byron Rushing is the sponsor, it would send it to small claims court instead. It would make the filing fee, I believe it's $20 or 25% of the ticket, whichever is less, and it would make it refundable if you win. So it makes much more sense. So it doesn't take many people, by the way. Each one of you makes a difference. If you place a call or send an email to the members of the House Ways and Means Committee, it really has an effect. So all of you who are motivated are asked to do that. Thank you.
All of the options, you won't fill it out. And you find people who change your app, you can do that all in general.
appreciate that. I think it's just our experience with surveys is people seem like, you know, there's only so many questions.
I wonder if there'd be a lot, but we said more lots when I first came to town, and I'm wondering if there could be a lot even a little further out. I don't know, like the old Honda place or something, I think it's pretty well, something like that. If it's that far.
Hi, I'm Mary Hathor from Optical Studio. Mary spoke earlier about infill, specifically at Optical Studio. I'm concerned that there's a proposal for four story and 55 unit building with Holyoke Street to be more intensive with it. So I'm very concerned about the parking and the traffic. I realize there's no longer requirements for parking new buildings. It seems like it makes sense to look at the general plan, whether there's a requirement or not.
Traffic and congestion and a lack of parking is a sign that Northampton is a successful place, right? So we want to sort of support that. And with that in mind, I would say, where possible, to really look at price discovery as a mechanism of distributing parking. And if there's not enough spots available, then it's probably a indicator that the spots aren't priced high enough. And that if implemented thoughtfully and delicately, you might say, I think some sort of dynamic pricing scheme or some way of determining, you know, what people are willing to pay such that we'll leave stocks open to the degree that others can use them. You know, I think that will sort of support the dynamism that exists here now. And I think something like that should definitely be weighed against a sort of major capital expenditure like a garage or, you know, some other system like that.
My name is Ben Hector. I actually don't live in Northampton. I live in Hatfield. And you're probably wondering why did I come to the speaking site, because my wife and I come to Northampton probably 4 to 5 times a week, because there's a lot going on in Northampton. There's a lot going on in Hatfield too, but there's more going on in Northampton. But there are 2 points that I just want to talk about for a moment. And one is railroad parking. Some of you may have noticed today that Amtrak rolled their first train to Northampton at about 5 o'clock today, inspection train. In 6 weeks, Amtrak's going to return service to Northampton after 25 years with daylight train that'll stop once a day in each direction. There's talk going on, as the mayor knows, to renew commuter service from Greenfield down to Springfield back and forth a couple times a day. And there's also talk at the state level to provide additional Amtrak service, possibly via Northampton, to Montreal, to Boston, and to Newhaven. So there's going to be a great deal of requirement, I believe, for parking around the railroad station, both for short-term, for people that need to park for a short amount of time to drop people off, people that would like to drop or stop for a day to park, or what my wife and I want to go to Boston, New York, in the short term, for a couple of days, where we can park for a Springfield, as well as Springfield, Northampton, and Greenfield, with the Amherst station closing, all the people in Amherst and all the people in the surrounding area are probably going to come to Northampton. And it's not clear to me, as a resident of this area, where all these people are going to park, because the current parking lot around where the platform is going to be built near Union Station is, I think, partially owned by a number of different parties. And it's not clear how that's all going to work. If anyone tries to go park there now, I think on a Friday or Saturday night, there's somebody standing there, it has to be $5. There's no train in the evening. But there's a lot of issues related to railroad parking, and I hope that that is part of this study, both in the short term and in the long term. And the second completely different point I want to mention is we're new residents to this area. We've been learning how to deal with crosswalks and how that relates to parking is, I would be very happy as both pedestrian and as a driver if the city would give up two spots on each side of the crosswalk to create what's called a bump out, so the pedestrians can step out into the crosswalk just a little bit, and the drivers can actually see where the pedestrian is standing there, rather than when I drive through the town and have to constantly go like this, looking to see if there's somebody coming on the crosswalk. If there weren't those two parking spots by the crosswalk with bump out, it would be much easier for me as a driver in my older age to see those pedestrians who try to cross, go across the park. Thank you.
You gotta think of the whole picture when you think about that. You gotta think about the mom and
was the parking gateway downtown, it was behind doors, and it was over in the other parking lot. And so it'll be the same, we should all be working together in this, trying to help people find, get more parking spaces, trying to make it affordable, trying to reduce stress. There are so many people that avoid coming to this town just because of parking. And it is one of the most heavily visited towns, and that's just becoming, so it's all over, it's coming up for that. And, I listened to that on the seniors, and they said, well, I come down here, I've got my mother, she can't walk up that hill. Okay, well, I continue the day, so it's not shuttle situation, that's really a good idea. Of course, we've got a lot of problems with people who go in the park and drive and jump on the shuttle bus from downtown, but, I mean, it's always going to happen no matter what. But I come from Boston, I'm old enough, I know this law. Thank you.
safe to represent the people working. I've got a lot of people working for us on very early in the morning. They don't feel safe parking long distance spots and walking to work, like the roundhouse lot or the drive. They don't feel very parking there that early in the morning and walking to work. And so they park behind, particularly the green area, because there's more parking by the roof and the post office for those guys. But at the green area, I've got a lot of staff behind the restaurant for that exact reason. And they have to feed the meter every 2 hours or actually move their car every 2 hours. Which is very difficult when you're working about in the hours. But there's not a lot of early morning places where employees are going to work at 6 a.m. But that's an issue for my staff.
I'm Robert Roth, and I live in Florence, but I have one business in downtown Northampton. I've lived on Crescent Street, I've lived on Elm Street. So, interestingly enough, I understand all your parking problems, believe it or not. I wish there was a presentation so I knew where you were going to go into your study, so we have 400 people actually going up on campus. But I would like to see a more easy payment, like Bill talked about, with either a credit card system or somebody could buy a parking kit where the time could be taken off by the either person instead of writing their ticket, they could run their handheld ticket over your ticket and take time right off of your kit. I'm one of those people that's usually pretty lucky about getting a parking space downtown again. And I'm usually so lucky that I have so much to believe that I forget the money. And I also have a problem with the three different ways to get parking downtown on Northampton. I think it can simplify the one-pay system, which either the meters or the ticket system. So if I think about somebody coming from out of town to park in Northampton, if you park on Main Street, you might not see the sign and the sign of meter in front of you, you might not realize that you're supposed to buy tickets from the sign. And I understand the ticket fee, but I really hate the fact that tickets double and you can walk through those days. So that's one of the most kind of crazy things that people need to pay. And I really would love, and I think the major city comes out of the mix for this, that if we could actually get that ticket, you could bring that to the machine and pay it immediately. If that experience is over, that's the worst part, take that away from you. That ticket sometimes can be a bad reminder of something you've done. And then the compound can make it work. So I really think it's all about simplicity. The parking garage is successful, no doubt. You think you can get a long-term parking space in the garage right now, which will be a long-term. And that is being parked. If anybody didn't know this, if you're going there on the train or if there's snow, you park in the parking garage. 50 cents an hour, you park there on one day. Education. Those employees, those downtown employees, they're our biggest offenders. And you know, if you look at our roster, we get great for parking tickets. We see who the common offenders are. A lot of them are people working downtown Northampton that are too lazy or just like that. You need exactly what you're not supposed to be doing in downtown Northampton. So these people need to be educated and they need to be prompted to speak to the employers or the Chamber of Commerce or the City of Northampton. It'd be great to get a liaison from the parking committee or the parking department. You know who these people are that owe $1,000. People getting repeatedly getting tickets, and then if they can see how maybe they can just be wised up, you know, and talk to them, let's do something different. I owned a store on Pleasant Street with that employee, and I did find it very difficult for the employees to park in downtown Northampton because there wasn't a great enough incentive. It wasn't enough of a differential to park in like the full lot van, it wasn't cheap enough to actually pay there, to go there. So the easy meal of walking that far, there wasn't enough to pay that. And they always thought, well, I'll put money in the meter and so forth. And that would be the other thing I'd say is everybody wants another garage right downtown, but if we really want to grow our downtown, we need to want to outline areas that would actually get a boost from seeing other parking available to them and the office for any people that are conducted down there. So make them explore other neighborhoods in Northampton, which is not explore them in the line.
Yeah.
perception is that, to me, it feels like parking enforcement and the issuance of tickets in town and how quickly they double in, you know, late fees, feels like it's not, just speaking perception-wise, feels like it's not about supporting the healthy flow and turnover of traffic in downtown to support downtown commerce. It seems like it's supporting the municipality, which is great and important, but like the changing over from the meters to put a quarter in the meter to go buy a ticket, and when that car leaves, there's no time that can transfer. I'm not suggesting that that's done for that reason, but that we don't have meters that you can't just put a credit card in. It just seems like things are done. I've paid a ton of money in this city towards tickets and late fees, and that's my own problem, and I do it happily, you know, sort of. But I sure wish it was a more user-friendly system that, you know, or that the city could, you know, try and come up with other creative ways to generate revenue that are not so dependent on public.
I spoke before, so thanks for hearing me again. I have 20 spots on a private lot, and many of us downtown who have private lots, because they were required originally, have our own enforcement problem, where many people either in town or out of town come in the day or the evening, and they just see an open lot, and they just assume there's no meters, we can park here. And you can have, for my 20 spots, I have five signs that say no parking after hours, parking for patrons only, and people have to be towed. So I have someone to tow. That isn't good for business. Not what I intend to do. I don't think there's money off the towing. But we, as people who have private lots, we also have our own enforcement issues. As the city grows and more development, I suspect that's going to be a bigger problem for people with private lots for their own business. So to look at that, as part of the study, would be helpful. We have a lot of overflow during the day in our lot for people who are not big. Well, at night.
Yeah, I think it, at times it does seem a bit arbitrary, and I partly think that, at least in my own experience, in observing some of what seems arbitrary lately, it is very much due to how much the city is growing, how fast the city is growing. I live in Ward 3, off of Market Street, on Grace Avenue. We have a lot of businesses opening in the last few years. And we just recently had a couple of cars get completed for parking too close to the entrance to the driveway. And this is something that's been a long-standing issue on our street, but no one has ever been ticketed for it. And everybody was a little stunned at, number one, we've always done this, and we didn't even know that it was cool. And two, how come all of a sudden, one Wednesday, 2 weeks ago, everybody got ticketed? And I think what likely happened is a resident call. And I think that for me with the lot, you know, the parking enforcement truly is very responsive to calls. And if you do have a persistent problem, we will come and check it out. But to everybody else, it seems very arbitrary, because I just don't know that monitoring for those kinds of behaviors are within their full range and scope of what they can do every day. On our street, we also have an issue with people coming. There's a restaurant on Market Street that is just around the corner, and then a lot of folks come and park illegally on Market Street, blocking the ability to go to the pizza. And they usually don't get ticketed as often after 6 o'clock. But if it's persistent, which at times it is, a car will park there, and then I'll do it by the bar and not leave for 3 hours, you'll notice it gets ticketed. And you know, I think partly that's because of residents call and reporting the data. So I'm not really sure what that yet entails. I think there's, that there are things that need enforcement that aren't enforced unless they're asked, because they're not part of a regular pattern. Grace Avenue has a meters, so nobody's pulling Grace Avenue normally. So when there is an issue and enforcement gets called, they're put in, and maybe they're even going to go check tomorrow or next week on Wednesday too, but it's not part of the regular.
I'm curious, I had suggested a few years back, putting in like some half-hour free spaces, and then they did put in the 15-minute free spaces. And I'm wondering if there are enough of them, if they're working well, if people are using them, et cetera. Because a lot of times they don't seem to be available. I'm sure it depends on time of day. I don't have the answers for that. I'm just asking. I think that's something to be looked into as part of it. Because if you're coming into town, pick up a paper from a lawyer's office, or pick up a slice of pizza, or whatever, and you just want to get right back in your car, you don't want to go to the garage. You don't want to go, you know, you're going to go to another town and see if you can do all of that, if you can. Short-term and long-term.
I know the business is about to concerns and things like that, but I would look at certain spots that are associated with especially in businesses that operate in the daytime and the nighttime, that are some problems and people have other parts of the business spot or like that. But that's why we're making the kind of receiver part of the business or not. But you know, we have this inventory of parking spaces that obviously we could use with other things like that, like readily available. I would think
Jim Krasinski, I was born in Northampton, and I grew up here in the park. And maybe it's a really good thing that we are having a conversation now, because it shows Northampton is coming of age, growing in businesses, or having some activity. But I was confronted with something the other day, it really just threw me when I looked at the infill new regulation, the new zoning ordinance, that allowed in the central business district to allow essentially unlimited number of units to be built, residential units and commercial spaces. There's something that business can build out to the end, and you don't have to have spaces. So, started thinking about that, especially with the Hoyoke College Street and Pleasant Street area, where there's a plan to have 55 new units, 1, 2, and 3 bedroom units, and presumably in the old days, I don't know what the requirements were there, was it 1.5 spaces per unit, 2 spaces per residential unit, or 2 spaces per residential unit, so you'd have to have 110 parking spaces. which would accommodate the individuals living there, the visitors. There's some businesses there. What was once the lumberyard, and there really wasn't much traffic or parking while the lumberyard, for the lumberyard use. Now, it's proposed, well, we'll have 41 spaces. And I know the Valley CDC was thinking of having their offices there, and I imagine they have conferences and visitors and other commercial spaces. So the thought started to occur to me, how many new infill units can be brought into the city under the new zoning? And I don't know if the city planner, Wayne Clyden, has generated that number for you, Mayor. That's something that we're familiar with. Based on the new zoning, and here you had right.
I mean, the theory of concern you have is you don't want people tearing down buildings and building purpose for it. You feel that you have a parking system that can I think that's a theory behind why we're supposed to get that happen by the parking requirement.
I was looking for some figures just to understand how many more units could be built under maximum zoning. If you filled up the space with new infill, would you be creating hundreds of more units? Possibly, without creating any additional parking? I just think it makes sense to look at that when we're thinking about parking and you're thinking about having and creating more residential spaces. People are going to end up on the streets in the parking spaces. And then there's going to be less time for someone to park in the parking spaces than they do create the businesses. And we're trying to develop, I think, the commercial slots around Pleasant Street to bring the downtown a little further. You can call it the Golden Triangle, Pond Street, Pleasant Street.
I don't know whether, I mean, I think the other philosophy is you live in downtown, as opposed to you sit, and you don't need a car, and you don't need a car.
Right.
You take TV care, and then you use a zip car, and you can have a lot of other things walking to the place, and also go to the lobby, and so the other part. I watch the development of the tool. And all I can say about progress is a little bit of traffic. And it really has to look like because people are so close to downtown, they don't have to do a car. So people don't need to do a drive. So, you know, that's the reason that we're defining that partially in terms of our capacity.
And we may be able to take the train down to Springfield or Hartford or Maven or whatever. But in the meantime, those folks are going to be coming and parking, not necessarily in the parking garage, but somewhere else. Thank you.
This is very quick. I know I already spoke. This is less than 6 seconds. Just a couple of people. I was trying to emphasize the perspective of the consumer. They can put on this business, the what's it like for someone to come here. A couple people mentioned that parking meters are more friendly to the user than the ticket system. I agree with that. It feels more friendly, and maybe it is that you get the extra 15 minutes or whatever, maybe that's part of it. It's a relatively small amount of money that they would use. So I just wanted to support what the other people said on that.
I don't know if it's okay if it's a bike, you know, transportation, you know, for people to ride around. I know I've been mad that a lot of places are more parking space for bikes or available allow people to park in the curb of that. I know I've been out there on the south street, and the park road has a lot of students and stuff like that. Now I'm trying to figure out the
Pricing, the timing, the
just pick up more and then to stand on the bylaw and get real life success in the bill. Anyway, that's part of my concern that I'm trying to.
Okay, then we never go in assuming that we're, you know, parking garages are expensive on the ticket. So we're not going into this with the assumption that we're going to look to see where to build something. With that assumption in mind, we're looking to make this into the system. And we're going to look into the future if there's enough suggestion that there could be the kind of bills that warrants additional resources, if we really are going to, you know, the system can't accommodate either what we've got now or what's coming, then we start talking about that. But that's not a good thing.
Survey's still up, and there's a place where if you have other thoughts and have other ideas, there's a place where you can insert comments. You can also